You're listening to The Dental Guys, episode 84, recap of the 2018 JPD Annual Review of the Literature. Well, John and Wes are together today in the same studio, happens every now and again. We're going to be recapping the 2018 Journal of Prosthetic Dentistry Review of the Literature. What does that mean? Well, over 500 studies of the most important things in dentistry. We're going to recap for you and pick out the pearls that you can take to your practice on Monday, the things that'll make a difference to take your practice to the next level in 2019, here with The Dental Guys.
This episode of The Dental Guys is brought to you by the Dental Crafters Network, your implant restorative connection. From surgical planning to patient-specific guides, quality implants, and final restorations, the Dental Crafters Network provides one relationship with infinite possibilities. Call 1-800-472-8302 today. That's 1-800-472-8302. Do you want to be able to understand, place, restore, and implement dental implants into your practice? Well, we've got the course for you, Restorative Driven Implants, taught by the Dental Guys.
Restorative Driven Implants is coming to Nashville in 2019. Head over to restorativedrivenimplants.com now to sign up. That's restorativedrivenimplants.com. And welcome to this week's episode of The Dental Guys. I'm Wes, The Dental Guy.
And I'm John, The Dental Guy.
John, where are we at here now?
Well, you know, this is my first time officially recording in your studio.
Yeah, if you're not watching on the YouTube version, you need to head over there and like us on YouTube.
Yeah.
Subscribe. And there's a lot of podcasts that actually co-release.
Right.
And we're one of those. Every episode we've ever done is on YouTube. It's another way to listen to The Dental Guys and watch The Dental Guys. And so, John, welcome to my studio.
Yeah, I mean, you've been in my place before. And, you know, this is the first time. I mean, I've been to your house before, but not to the studio.
Right, so why are you down here?
Well,
down
here. Down, that's right.
Down.
Came down.
Came down.
Came down. So I've got two big implant cases tomorrow with the specialist here in your town.
Mm-hmm.
And so I drove down here, and we're hanging. Mm-hmm. Doing some work here, and then I'm going to be getting up early tomorrow, heading over and doing some work. A lab technician flew down for these cases, some big stuff.
Your lab flew in for this?
Lab technician flew down from way out of state for these cases.
That's some dedication right there.
Yeah, I mean, these are a big deal, and we've been working a long while on them, so it's going to be a big day tomorrow. Going to be, going to be dropping some titanium in. I'm not actually doing surgery tomorrow. I'm just doing the prosthetic side, but...
Mm-hmm.
Super exciting. So, yeah, I got to spend a little time. Figured we'd, come down and record an episode.
Yeah, no, this episode, and we'll get to that here in just a minute, it's going to be amazing. So, stay tuned to that. So, talking about titanium, hey, look, if you were going to sign up for the Nashville course, it's full.
Restorative driven implants is what you're talking about.
Went to Nashville. It's full. It's actually starting here when, I guess, here in a couple weeks.
About the time you listen to this, it's probably already going.
Yeah. So, looking forward to seeing you there if you're heading out to Nashville for Series 1 and Series 2 of Restorative Driven Implants. But it turns out, we're ready to kind of announce where we're going in the fall.
Yeah.
And, hey, listen, tickets are being sold right now.
That's right. So if you head over to restorativedrivenimplants.com, you're going to see that we are coming to Des Moines, Iowa in the fall, so back to the Midwest. And we're excited about that. We've got some good connections out there in Iowa that we've been able to meet some good people and to kind of get us interested, telling us, hey, well, you guys need to come out here. We've got some people who are really excited about implants.
Right.
And it doesn't mean you have to be from Iowa to come out there, but there's lots of people in the Midwest we've met that are looking for this kind of training, and we're excited to get out there. I already have met some of the people that are going to be at the class.
I think the thing about restorative driven implants that I like, it's about taking things that are complex, making them simple. If you've never placed dental implants and you're coming to this course, what you're going to learn is good bread and butter implant dentistry.
Yeah, everyday implant dentistry that you can really bring to your practice, but not just teaching you to put implants in. We're teaching you the basics of why you should do what you should do, and really trying to create a system, because that's the thing we find is missing in a lot of implant courses, is a systematized approach that is based on the prosthetic outcome, not just putting titanium into bone, but understanding where you're doing it, how you're doing it, having a protocol, having a system, That's something that we find, that's why we started the course. We wanted to have a systematized approach because it's what we use in our practices.
Right.
And we're excited to get to show you that. And also, we're going to be heading just in this next month, mm-hmm. February, to Chicago. And you might be thinking we're going to say Chicago Midwinter, and we
right.
will be there for a short time.
Mm-hmm.
But mainly, we're going to be at the American Academy of Fixed Prosthodontics.
Whoa, what kind of, what is this meeting?
Yeah.
American Academy right. of Fixed Prosthodontics?
Like, what is that all about? Well, if you are a prosthodontist, you've heard of it. If you are a general dentist, you might not have, but it's where some of the best minds and brightest minds in fixed prosthodontics come together to talk about research mm-hmm. and to talk about what's new and techniques. And there's an incredible set of people that are going to be there. We're going to have opportunity to interview some of those folks that are going to be on the main stage there.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to be podcasting from the Kettenbach booth as well. We're excited about that. Getting to meet some people there. So if you're at that meeting, come by and see us.
Check us out.
Come by and do some discussion with us and get in on maybe some of the interviews we'll be able to do with some pretty big names out there at this mm-hmm. meeting. It's pretty exciting.
I'm excited about it. It's an opportunity for us to mingle with people maybe we haven't met before. I'm interested because there's going to be some people there that have done some of the research that we've quoted on the show.
Yeah.
And some of the things that we read in the Journal of Prosthetic Dentistry,
right.
those people will be at this meeting. We're going to have an opportunity to maybe interview these people and talk about some high-level topics when it comes to what you're doing on a day-to-day basis.
Right. This isn't just a meeting that is for prosthodontists. You know, it
right.
just so happens a lot of these people are prosthodontist researchers.
Right.
But there are also a lot of clinical people there kind of bringing together the researchers and the clinicians. And
right.
that's what we're all about on the show, is trying to kind of take the research and translate that into clinical practice.
This is Justin Goodbrand. Here is today's tip.
If you have some extra money, should you apply the cash to debt or invest it? The decision goes back to your personal planning goals. If markets are down or there's a strategic opportunity to buy something that's limited to you, like the building your practice is in, then maybe now's the time to invest. On the other hand, if you want to pay down debts, check with your CFP or CPA for tax benefits. Just remember that if you eliminate debt, you will need to do some additional tax planning. For more information about today's topic and other dental related topics, head over to financiallysimple.com/dentist. Until next time, make it a great day.
This tip is for informational purposes only. Please speak to a competent financial advisor regarding your specific needs. Justin Goodbread is an investment advisor representative of Heritage Investors, a registered investment advisor. Visit heritageinvestor.com or financiallysimple.com for additional information.
Today, we are covering the December 2018 issue of the Journal of Prosthetic Dentistry. John and I have been members of the Journal of Prosthetic Dentistry for many years. And well, actually, it's the American Academy of Restorative Dentistry. And this is their amazing featured issue, basically the annual review of scientific literature. Now, the amount of work that goes into this, like I got to thinking about this,
yeah.
like the biography.
Yeah, they usually have,
it's amazing,
the biography, 500 or 600 citations.
It's unbelievable.
You know, these good people go through, and I know, like, let's just be honest, it's not the authors reading all these things, it's the grad students probably reading a lot of it, but they're
right.
basically saying, hey, let's talk about all, as the, I think the New York Times used to say, all the news that's fit to print.
Right.
And basically anything that they think is relevant to dentistry
mm.
in a given area, say cariology or
mm-hmm.
composite dentistry or whatever, they're going to put all of that they feel is important into a one page or less, or maybe a half a page. So can you imagine having to summarize everything that's basically new in, say, I don't know, sleep medicine into maybe 6 or 7 paragraphs?
Right.
You know, how many papers you'd have to read and figure out what's really important.
So let me just give you a little hand, little just how many articles that were reviewed in how many disciplines.
Mm.
A total of 437 articles
nice.
In 7 disciplines were identified or reviewed. And this is just impressive. And it always is impressive to us. It takes a couple of nights
yeah.
of just an undisturbed
yeah.
reading and rereading to just really drink it all in and kind of pull out some of the things. And that's what we did. We're not going to go through this and like pick everything out. In fact, John and I basically just said, you read it, I'll read it, and we'll just pick out a few things. And then I kind of paired up what really meant a lot to both of us.
Yeah.
And we're going to break this into three segments this evening for you. And the first topic is dental implants.
Yeah.
And so let's talk a little bit about this first article that this review about torque wrenches.
Yeah.
Now, John, you and I've talked about torque wrenches before when it comes to dental implants, and the fact that in the 80s, torque wrenches weren't even available for us to use on our prosthetics. So, and the connection with implants, like the abutment to prosthetic, the prosthetic connection to the implant interface, it wasn't that good because milling technology wasn't there.
Right.
Then milling technology got better, and then we were able to actually create a torque wrench mm-hmm. and actually create more torque or more seating torque of the abutment to the fixture.
Right.
That in itself eliminated some of this screw loosening.
Right, just the better connection.
Right, yeah. But how many dentists actually have torque wrenches today?
Yeah, that's a very disturbing thing. I think the best way to find that out is you talk to your implant rep.
Right.
You know, and it's often pretty disturbing when you talk to implant representatives about how bad it really is.
Right.
You know, they talk about how people want to borrow their torque wrenches all the time. They don't actually own the torque wrench, which is disturbing. So, mm-hmm. you know, if you do own a torque wrench, though, the question that sometimes comes up is,
well, how often is it even accurate?
Right.
Right?
Right. Is it accurate? And how often do you need to calibrate it?
We run these things through autoclaves every single time we use them.
Right.
What is that doing to the mechanisms there?
Right.
So the study was basically they tested five devices, and they did two spring type. Now, the spring type are the kind that you can actually see the spring mm-hmm. and you actually twist the end of the instrument and it tightens or loosens the spring. And that in turn makes it harder or easier mm-hmm. to actually turn the wrench.
Well, that's dark, yeah.
Right, exactly. There was two spring types and then the two friction type.
Right.
Now tell me about the friction type.
Yeah, well, the friction type are basically you've seen most people I think have seen. There's different types of friction. You've got the beam type that we see, and then you've got the type again that's a twist. And I think that the main focus of this article was to look at this question of how well do these things actually, how accurate are they? Number one, they were comparing the electronic ones to the manual.
Yeah.
Because I think that, you know, most people think, well, you know, electronic is, that's got to be better.
Right.
Because it's electronic.
Well, there and to be honest with you, the electronic's probably, it's mechanical as well, but it's probably got some kind of potentiometer in there or something like that. So,
and they when they looked at this, they found that all of them were lower.
Whoa.
All of them.
All of them.
Yeah. All of them were lower, and it ranges from 7% to 28%. Lower, and that's a lot.
So why in the world is this important to us?
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Like that's what we want to ask. Like, why is this even worth bringing up?
Mm-hmm.
So if we have torque wrenches to prevent screw loosening, then what we're saying is that this could contribute because our torque wrenches are under torquing to the manufacturer recommended torque. So let's talk about that. The average torque seating torque of an abutment to implant is probably between 20 and 30 newton centimeters.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I've seen it higher. I've seen it lower.
Right.
Okay. But 20 to 30 is on average.
Yep.
So what we're saying is you're not going to achieve the torque that you need to seat the prosthetic to
right. and
the fixture.
And depending on the connection that you're working with, you know, the screw is more or less important.
Right.
In some connections, the screw is everything. And so if you're under torquing your screw by 30% of the torque,
that's bad.
You may have some issues with screw loosening.
Right.
You may have an abutment that's not fully seated, which can cause some issues with the connection being more loose, especially if it's a connection that's more of a flat to flat type of connection.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So that could be an issue.
Yeah. So I think that what this tells us is in these connections where you have a problem with either not fully seating your abutment or screw loosening, the question is this going to cause long-term problems for some of our implants?
Well, I'm going to tell you right now, is so some of these deeper connections, it's going to be a problem.
Yeah.
Because one of the deepest connections that I've ever used, the very first time that I did it, I forgot to torque it, okay? And I hand tightened it. Now, we know that your fingers can do about 10 to 15 newton centimeters on a good day, okay? And so on your good day, it's probably 15 to 20, but my good day is 10 to 15, okay?
Right.
So it wasn't for about 4 or 5 months that the patient, guess what? My implant crown is loose.
Hmm.
So what if it's indiscernible? Like, meaning like you torqued it down, okay, but not enough.
Mm-hmm.
And then over time, there's this movement, this micro movement,
yeah.
And that gap that we talk about.
Yeah.
And then do we think that there could be some possible like periodontal problems?
Yeah. I mean, there's a question about, you know, pumping bacteria around in that connection, just the same thing we talk about with loose connections. Mm-hmm. So I think that, you know, bottom line on this is that you be aware mm-hmm. that, first of all, there's a problem of mm-hmm. these things under torquing. Number two, the electronic ones, I'd probably stay away from those.
Yeah.
I mean,
not good, right?
Probably not a good thing to use them at all. And just also realize that if you aren't calibrating your torque wrenches, mm-hmm. probably need to be doing that. You know, another thing too, I've just noticed talking to people is they rarely are actually autoclaving their torque wrenches correctly. They're not taking them apart. A right. lot of times they're just throwing the whole thing in there.
That's a good point. I'm guilty.
Yeah, if you look at your torque wrench instructions, they talk about how to take them apart.
That's a pain in the rear, then, yeah, man. Every single time you're supposed to take a thing apart.
You really are, and then you're supposed to, a lot of times, put some lubrication back right. on there again. If you haven't done that in a while, I think it's just a good thing to maybe, you know, have the manufacturer do a calibration.
And have the manufacturer do a calibration, and then also we know from research that the beam reach, where we're not tested here, mm-hmm. are the most accurate.
Yep, yep.
There are some ones out there, I think, that supposedly claim to maintain accuracy for a year,
mm-hmm.
and then you are allowed to send them in and they recalibrate them for you.
Yeah.
I won't mention any names, but we do know that there are some out there that claim these things. The point is, why is this? What are our suggestions? One, know that it's probably under torque. Two, have your torque wrench tested.
Right.
Or just get a new one.
Right.
You know?
Right. Just from time to time,
get a new one.
Replace it. And,
right.
And don't, and if you're having screw loosening and it's more than once every 5 years, then you might want to check your torque wrenches.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
For sure.
So, what about this next thing? Third party abutments versus OEM.
We've had
it
this
keeps
discussion
coming up,
yeah, yeah,
and they brought it up in a big way,
yeah.
And why would third party abutments be a problem?
Well, that was interesting. You know, I think that anybody that has read about this or looked into this or talked to their lab, you know, first of all, third party abutments are a huge business nowadays because yeah. the OEM abutment is more expensive in many cases. Mm-hmm. And so people have looked for inexpensive alternatives to save money for themselves, for their patients. And mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I get that, totally get that.
Mm-hmm.
But what we see is because of a lot of patent protection,
right.
These third-party abutments have to be often a little different.
They're altered.
And that mm-hmm. difference is often a less deep connection or a less than
just something
ideal
different,
angle.
Right?
Yeah, just something different.
Something different.
And the question is, are they as good? You know, are they as good? Do they fit as well? Are they as good at what they're supposed to do? And, you know, what we see in this study is that they did not show the same strength. It was especially a problem with zirconia, but even with titanium.
Not as bad as zirconia.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. And even with titanium, though, there yeah. was a definite difference between the strength and the testing showed that they weren't as strong.
From
and
what
then,
I could tell, too, the testing was legit because they're using yeah. like a super-duper commercial lab for this.
Right, a big lab yeah. that's well-known,
well-known,
that makes a lot of these. It's not just some little lab somewhere.
And they compared that to the actual OEM mills,
right.
which we know are special mills, too.
Right.
But guess what? They've got the milling strategies.
Right.
They're proprietary mills. They're not yep. telling anybody their milling strategies. Even yep. if their abutment's patent's gone,
right.
their milling strategies are their own.
Yeah.
They're not telling people that.
Yeah. And I think that I certainly didn't think this would be as big of a deal, you know, but the
we
more
heard,
that I read about it.
A couple years ago, we heard Mish mm-hmm. get on the stage and he showed all this stuff
right.
about OEM parts versus, you know, knockoffs.
Right.
And the whole point of the thing was that he's concerned that we're going to see harm to the implant and the patient because
right.
of this.
Right.
Just because it's cheaper. You know, so what's our concern with this? I mean, I think that it again, when it comes up again in a summation mm-hmm. of what we think we need to be looking at, I think we got to be careful.
Yeah.
I think the long-term effect is the problem,
right?
Not the short-term.
Right. In the short-term, you're probably not going to see a difference.
See a problem.
But in 10 years,
could this contribute to a little bit more bone loss or more issues with screw loosening? You know, are you going to see, is this a reason for peri-implantitis? You know, there's some people that even would say that. I don't know that I'd go that far, but I would say we need to be careful. And, you know, when it comes down to it, if the patient's paying for a $4,000 or $5,000tooth replacement, if the difference is $100,
right,
and we're not getting paid by an implant company to say this, I would spend the extra money on an OEM part if I could.
Right.
If I could.
You know, most of my cases are done with OEM parts. Now, it turns out that there's some old implants that we're always working around, and you're going to have to use some stuff that is not OEM because it's almost impossible. And so going forward, you know, we really think that you got to be careful.
Right.
And that you need to look at this. It keeps coming up. And when I see it keep coming up, it's a concern.
And at least if you're using non-OEM parts, make sure that the lab, that you ask your lab if these are FDA approved connection parts, because that's another big issue is that a lot of, I mean, any lab with a milling machine and some, you know, idea of what to do can mill an abutment connection. But most of those are actually illegal to use because they're not tested. So do you need to be, you need to be asking your lab, where do you get your blanks from? Where do you get your parts from? And if they're milling them themselves, then you need to be asking, well, are you, you know, are you approved to do this? Is this an FDA approved part? I don't really care. I shouldn't say this maybe, but I don't really care so much about the FDA approval as much as I just care about the fact that there's some testing being
done. Consistency and predictability.
Yeah. Is it really going to work? How do you know?
You know, precision is repeatability, and then accuracy is how close is it to the fit and finish of what the manufacturer intended.
Right.
And so, yeah, the FDA is going to test these things at 30-degree angles.
Yeah.
And they're going to cyclic load them, and you know, and they're going to make sure that they don't break at a certain place. And they're going to give their kind of thumbs up on that.
Right.
And but there are people out there that are milling stuff, and you're buying it.
Well, the interesting thing to me, and this wasn't in this research article, but you know, it's interesting. I've been hearing a lot just last week. I was on the phone.
I sense a rant coming on.
Yeah, I wasn't planning on talking about this, but it just makes me think about this. Just last week, I was on the phone with a rep from an implant company who's recently acquired by a capital investment company who's moving manufacturing to another place in the world out of the U.S. And they were talking about how this company, and it's one of these companies that's producing implants that have a clone connection, right? So they're saying, you know, we have an Astra connection, old Astra connection, and then this, they also have a Zimmer style version of the same connection.
So like a TX. And
they have an Astra TX type connection. They have a Zimmer screw vent, you know, TSV type of connection. And then they have a Nobel tie-loop type of connection.
So just choose your flavor. They've got it.
Right. So that is a whole other discussion, you know, because we talk about these third-party abutments. But what about third-party implants? What about, you know, somebody that has a copy of the Astra TX connection? Is it as good as the Astra TX connection? And what about now you have a non-OEM implant and a non-OEM part that's going into that implant? Are you doubling the problem of inaccuracy when you copy not only the abutment with a non-OEM, but with the implant with a non-OEM? No one's done that study that I've ever seen. Are we getting twice the problems, or is it better because maybe the company's making both parts, even though they're both copies? Can they figure that out? No one really knows, but we got all these knockoff connections everywhere, Wes. I mean, we've got how many companies have a Zimmer connection now, right?
Right.
And I used to think, oh, they're all the same probably. And really, they're not.
They're not.
They're not all the same, you know?
I mean, anything that's non-OEM for your car. Let's say that your car that you're driving out there, okay, you get in a wreck tonight.
Yeah.
Okay? And, you know, the appraiser comes to you, and they do this all the time. You know, your insurance company's going to pay you this. We can either use OEM parts or we can use non-OEM parts.
Right.
And let's say that they say, you know, your drive shaft. It's toast, dude.
Right.
You know? They got a non-OEM drive shaft for your car.
Right.
And it's $500 cheaper. What do you want to put in there?
Right.
What if it's your brakes?
Yeah. Well, I would equate it even more. You know, the other dentist I work with, he's a pilot, you know?
Oh my.
And so that's a whole other level because the FAA says if it's not a part that's been tested by the FAA, it's actually illegal for you to put in your plane. And so I think, you know, the question is,
so you're saying parts that we're putting in people's bodies.
Right.
How mission critical are
these parts? You know, are these parts that we can say, it's just a lug nut, maybe it'll be fine, or it's right. You know, it's a part of my dashboard, FAA approved kind of thing we need to be looking for?
Here's the thing, John. This is a fairly new discussion. Okay, yeah. It's not a 20-year-old discussion because we didn't have OEM knockoffs back in the 90s.
Right?
Did we?
No, there weren't enough. This wasn't enough information for that. Nobody could afford
milling machines,
right?
Other than the big Joes,
right?
You know, now companies are getting bought up by other companies. Yeah, we're having that. Bigger companies are becoming bigger. They're staying big,
right?
But there's a lot of smaller companies. Like, dude, look how many implants there are.
Right.
There's 1,500 implant bodies.
So what I'd love to do is I'd love to have somebody from one of these third-party milling companies on the show.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you?
Yeah.
I'd love to have somebody come in here from a third-party milling company to come in and prove to us or show us
or
where...
Or tell us why it's so hard.
Are we wrong about this?
Right.
Because I used to think that there were some companies like the one, and I'm not going to say the name because I don't want to say the name, but the company, one of the companies cited in the study is probably the biggest third-party implant part manufacturer in the world. And what we've seen time and time again, their milling machines are some of the worst.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the worst. If you read the studies,
it's bad.
It's bad. Some of the companies that I've seen that are actually, I thought were worse companies, have better milling than some of the bigger companies. So I'd love to have somebody on here who we could talk to about this and say, why is it so bad, or is it as bad as we're saying?
If you all know people out there, we'd love to talk to them. We're not looking at throwing people under the bus. We want to understand more about
it. But right as it is now, I think it's a problem.
I think it is.
Yeah.
Let's go on to the next thing here is, again, another topic that we see keep coming up is this idea of peri-implantitis.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole idea about this peri-implantitis thought was, John, titanium oxide corrodes.
Right.
So let's say, here's the case, you get a little bit of bone loss and you get one or two threads exposed in the posterior. You don't even see that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because that's sub G.
Right.
Right? Because you did your implant placement and you placed it subcrestal.
Mm-hmm.
For whatever reason, you got a thread or two exposed. Not a big deal. Not even an aesthetic problem.
Right.
But what is going on there? What did this study show us?
Yeah, and so it showed that this corrosion, this degradation of titanium is actually increasing all the pro-inflammatory cytokines around this area, and actually it looks a lot like periodontal disease and the response that we're seeing from an inflammatory response to the titanium oxide itself. And it calls into question that maybe is there some, if you want to call it foreign body reaction, or is it an inflammatory reaction? Is this a, you know, inflammation that is, you know, steady state like we've talked about before on the show? That is almost a rejection of this titanium. Could the titanium itself be part of the problem?
Right.
And could we actually be needing to worry about the breakdown of titanium on
so
these implants?
Titanium's dissolving under the conditions that the mouth are put under a day-to-day basis. We were just talking to an ex-orthopedic rep over dinner tonight, and he was talking about like the differences between their surgical techniques. I mean, they're done in a sterile field.
Right.
They're placed in somebody's knee or hip. Those things are sterile the entire time you're working on them, and then you suture them up, and they remain sterile the entire time they're in your body.
Right.
The problem with the mouth is that it is a harsh environment.
Yeah.
There's acids, there's things people are eating and drinking. Heck, I was just talking about this mouth rinse that my wife bought, and we tested it, called the company. The pH was 2.7.
Oh, man.
You know, and actually she threw it away. She's like, no, I'm not going to throw it away. She actually used it to clean her toilet bowl. Made the toilet bowl smell amazing, and it cleaned amazing.
Yeah.
So what's that doing to your titanium?
Right.
You know, what are patients putting in their mouth, and what is that doing to the dissolution?
Right.
Of the metals in your mouth.
Yeah, there's a lot of things that in our diet would contribute to this problem.
Right.
And I think there's, again, this is still early research, but there's, you know, the different surface technologies that we have on our implants.
Right.
You know, does that make it better to have a roughened surface at the top or a polished collar? You know, these are all still things we're asking.
Some of you guys that are listening to this show are in your 20s, you're in dental school. Some of you guys are listening to the show, you're in your 50s and 60s. I'm in my, early 40s. Gosh, I hate saying that. 41. Man. John's in his late 30s. Here's the thing. John and I are going to be dabbling in implant dentistry for the rest of our career. Most of you that are listening to this show are going to be dabbling in implant dentistry for the rest of your career. It's what we're talking about now that we need to take to heart. And why is this important to us? Get your implants in bone.
Yeah, that's true.
Because if you don't get your implants in bone, they're not in a sterile field.
Right,
And you know what else this tells me about our patients is they better have a clean mouth.
Yeah, that's right.
Because you can't, a patient lost that tooth for a reason, John. They didn't just come in and say, hey, I'm tired of number 19.
Right.
Take it out and put an implant in. They didn't just come in and say, hey, I knocked my tooth out tonight. I want you to put an implant in because implants are for life.
Right.
And I think we have to be very careful. I love implants. They have a very high success rate when it comes from an integration standpoint. They work. But it's the revisions that you and I are going to deal with because of things that we're seeing now that we don't even know about.
Right.
I mean, heck, we don't even know. There's more articles in here that talk about peri-implantitis and how to take care of this. We don't even know how to treat that.
Right. We're still kind of in the same boat here. We don't exactly know what to do, but it is interesting to follow this idea of what titanium itself and titanium particles, all of that, could mean long-term. And, it also, this we saw just kind of another confirmation in this same article about soft tissue. Mm. Two things with that, and we've talked about this time and time again now, starting back with some of the work that Tomas Lingavicius did about, soft tissue thickness. But I think we're starting to see that possibly that platform switching, first of all, long-term by increasing maybe the volume of tissue is helping to maintain bone. And I think that that's something that, has been controversial.
Mm.
I think we're seeing that there is some advantage to it because it was the question always that Lingavicius tried to ask was it really the platform shift or was it just the soft
surgical
tissue?
Surgical placement.
Right, how deep you placed it. And I think that both things matter. Probably the placement matters more, but I think in all things being equal, platform shifting seems to have an effect.
And essentially what platform switching is doing is it's saying that you have a fixture size of, say, 4 millimeters. Mm-hmm. The implant's 4. The prosthetic abutment is actually inset, say, to 3.5.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, you have, at that abutment to implant connection, more blood supply.
Right.
And so what does that mean? Well, more blood supply means more protection.
Right.
More natural protection from whatever we're dealing with around that implant.
And I think we're starting to see now that the micro gap argument is maybe less of an issue than the actual soft tissue volume and blood supply. And I think that that's where, Lingavicius and that type of line of thinking lines up with what we're saying. And we also had a couple articles talking about keratinized gingiva and how important it was. Again, controversial. You wouldn't think it's been, but it has been a bit controversial about is that important?
Mm-hmm.
Seems to be important.
Well, I think, when we look at the type of implant we're placing it and the type of implants that we've placed in the past and then what we're restoring now, all of these implants, we've always trended you and I to something that either has quote unquote platform switching built in or it has a narrow neck or a reverse bevel, or we can platform switch it to help us out. I think we should continue looking at those things.
Oh, yeah.
I think we should really start to just say, hey, if you can platform switch, if it's not already built into the prosthetic platform, then do it.
Right. And I think too, focus on if you have any possibility of getting keratinized gingiva around your implant, aim for that. And that's where, as we've seen in RDI, when we're teaching this, we're talking about guiding. The problem with guiding we see is that oftentimes people are just
punching,
using a soft tissue punch, and they don't even look at where they're punching, and they maybe
punch right through the mucogingival junction.
They have no idea because the lab that made the guide doesn't know where the mucogingival junction is. So once again, as we sometimes say, you got to be a doctor.
Right.
And so if we know keratinized gingiva matters, as these studies seem to indicate, that make sure if you're placing implants, especially through a guide, that you know where your soft tissue is, where that mucogingival junction is. I mean, it sounds basic, but it's something that's sometimes not being paid attention to. So let's totally change topics.
Oh man,
because we've been Wes and I, as you guys know, we've really been diving in over the last especially year or two into Airway.
Let me just say this too. With the Airway remark, I haven't responded to one of our longtime listeners out there. His first name's Anthony. I won't say his last name. But I want you to know that I have a very grand answer for that. You know?
I know.
And it's a good answer. It's an answer I think that he will like. But I even started to type it and put it together. And honestly, I think we need to answer it on the show. Not tonight.
Yeah.
But I think it needs to be part of the show. And we would help make that. So, Anthony, if you're listening to this, kudos to you for bringing it up, because you brought up some very good points and things that John and I can answer from that about a previous interview with Rebecca Bacow. And so sleep has become a real game changer for you and I.
Sure.
I was just in the oral surgeon's office today, this afternoon, working on an implant patient, and he was in the next room post-oping a patient that he did orthognathic surgery on.
Mm-hmm.
This guy was so apneic that he would not sit down in the dental exam chair and lay back because he could not breathe laying down. He could not sleep.
Wow.
He couldn't take a walk with his wife. He couldn't lose weight. He couldn't do anything. The doctor did the bimaxillary expansion. He did mandibular expansion, took his airway that was the size of a piece of pencil lead and make it the proper size.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? The guy's already lost 50 pounds.
Yeah.
The guy's breathing. The guy's off his CPAP.
Yeah, it's a game changer.
It's a game changer.
So this article that we're going to talk about here had a very interesting conclusion, and it was a correlation between periodontal disease and problems with sleep. But it was about duration of sleep, which was interesting. And this, you know, so many articles that have shown these interesting correlations with perio. And a lot of times, if you look at the articles, they're pretty poorly done.
Yeah.
They're just like, you know, kind of this loose correlation, but they really controlled for a lot of variables in this study.
It was really good.
And it really seemed to show that there is an independent association between sleep duration and prevalence of perio.
So basically what you're saying is, if I don't sleep 7 to 8 hours tonight, that I'm going to increase my risk of periodontal disease.
That's what the study showed, and it really seemed like this was a very legit study that was showing this, and that would also directly be correlated with airway problems and all these patients we're talking to about apnea.
It makes total sense, because you see patients come in your practice and you're like, you know what? They've got to be stressed.
Yeah.
And you ask them and they're not sleeping.
Right.
And they've got gingivitis, and yet they brush their teeth really good.
Yep.
So what the heck, man?
Right.
And really, this study was pretty good. I don't think that we can no longer ignore the effects of sleep on oral health.
Yeah. I think we at least have to acknowledge whether or not you're treating it yourself. That's not what's important.
Just acknowledge.
Yeah, acknowledge it. It needs to be part of our health history.
Yes.
For sure. I think we need to be asking questions about at least whether there's been a diagnosis or discussion with it, and we need to have it integrate into our examination in some way.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that if you don't know how to do that, you need to seek out some training in order to figure out how to integrate into practice. Because when periodontal disease, which is so prevalent, if we could make a difference there in just knowing who's sleeping well, I mean, that could be a major thing.
Right, right. I mean, it's one of these things now that if you're in any area of your practice, the very first thing I would just say do is just put something on your medical history about, hey, do you snore?
Right.
You know? And that, hey, I saw that you mentioned that you snore.
Right.
And do you sleep good? I sleep terrible.
Right.
Hey, let me refer you to a sleep doctor, because I'm seeing some issues in your gums, in your throat. And it doesn't take much knowledge. A weekend course and just the awareness around what sleep can do, for your patients, it's unbelievable.
Yeah, it changes things.
So one of the things that we've been using to treat sleep in our practices for our patients that have failed CPAP and for patients that have declined CPAP has been oral appliance therapy, mandibular advancement devices. And so I think that there was an interesting quote here about this if you're looking at this with us on 857, there's a good beginning thought process to what oral appliance therapy does for the body.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, a CPAP is a mechanical device that's aiding the body in breathing,
mm-hmm.
whereas a oral appliance device, a mandibular advancement device, is using more a physiological process, helping the muscles, posturing the jaw forward. And it could be that long term we see these oral appliance therapies becoming maybe more favored.
Right.
Okay. Now we're not saying that.
Right.
But we're saying that the doctors that are quoted here,
right,
they feel like that this is, hey, we're seeing some good data here. In
right.
fact, the research that here that shows that after 1.5 years, there was some great improvements
right.
From oral appliance
and therapy. A lot of subjective and objective things.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So, but I thought that idea that CPAP is basically taking over for your body
right.
versus appliance therapy. It's trying to help your body, still using your body's own essentially reflexes.
That's right.
You know, to try to compensate for this problem. You know, how much does that have to do with, you know, trying to train your own body or your own muscles to be able to deal with this problem versus just putting you on a ventilator, if you will?
That's
you
right.
know, and I think that doesn't mean that CPAP's bad. It's awesome.
Yeah, it's still the go-to.
Yeah, but mm-hmm. but I think we're doing good things for our patients with oral appliance therapy. I think that's kind of what I got from this is, man, we're doing good things for these people. It's working, and if they can't tolerate CPAP, this is a great alternative, and I think we're helping people to use their own physiologic responses to these problems and giving them just a little bit of a help with that.
Yeah, so why is this important to us? It just gives us more evidence that oral appliance therapy can help our patients.
Yeah.
And there was some more research in there even talking about upper airway resistance syndrome.
Right, saying that you can use mandibular advancement devices to treat upper airway resistance, which is interesting. This was the first study I think I've seen that showed real effectiveness
mm-hmm.
because it wasn't that we didn't think it could work, but we didn't really have a lot of data on that.
Right.
Whether it could upper airway resistance, you think, well, don't you have to treat the upper airway?
Right.
But it seems that these appliances are helping even with these upper airway resistance patients more than I would have thought.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool too, to know that we can have an effect on these patients. Cause I don't know about, I don't want to go down that rabbit hole too far, but just, there's a ton of upper airway resistance patients out there, Wes.
I mean, what I'm treating the most of.
Right, because we're seeing this now.
Well, they don't qualify for CPAP.
Right, it's not the same type of patient, yeah. but it's patients. You may have a lot more of these in your practice than you think. So if you don't know what that means, you don't know what UARS is,
right.
do some Googling and then go take some courses because it definitely
Dude,
is another
so
game changer.
There's so many abbreviations. It's crazy.
Yeah.
You know, and it's unreal. So what about, okay, long-term use of oral appliance therapy? Like everybody talks about, oh man, you're going to have a posterior open bite because of oral appliances. Your jaw is going to change shape. Your face is going to look weird after
right.
wearing oral appliance for a long time.
Right.
John.
Yeah. And we know that, yeah, things can change and will change. In fact, what we were taught in our airway courses is almost always that things change.
So I'm an oral appliance user.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I've been using one since I was diagnosed with mild obstructive sleep apnea. Snore a little bit. Okay. A little upper airway resistance syndrome. RDI 8.0 without the device. AHI 6.9.
Yeah.
Okay. When I wear a device, 1.5 AHI. RDI, it's like 0.9.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's working.
So it's working. So I've been wearing it for almost 2 years.
Right.
Okay. Bite feels great.
Right.
I don't notice any changes.
And I think that the point of this study was everybody will probably have some small changes,
mm-hmm.
but the changes won't be clinically relevant.
Right. So they did a three-dimensional analysis
mm-hmm.
where they took CTs and all this kind of stuff and measured all these points. There were significant changes.
Right.
But they were clinically irrelevant. You
right.
weren't even able to see that there was
right.
any issue.
And there are, as the study said, there are going to be some outliers to that, but it's just not, it's certainly well, if you talk about risk versus benefit,
mm-hmm.
this just, I think, supports the idea that the risks are low.
Does this make you feel better about recommending OAT?
Oh, for sure.
Right.
Because
now,
you feel like that the risks are just low, that things are going to change.
So when we came back from the occlusion course, both you and I did, this was before we started doing sleep, we were doing a lot of anterior discluding devices.
Right.
And there, the big risk there with anterior discluding devices, if you don't put posterior support on them, is that you can have eruption
mm-hmm.
or an open bite in certain patients.
Right.
And that's a concern too. It's so rare, but you can see it happen. The key here, you key here is patient must be informed.
That's right. You just have to tell the patient, look, you may have changes from this appliance.
I don't just tell them, I have them sign it.
Yeah, and that's a reasonable thing. Yeah. And just to have them understand that if this changes, we're trying to do good things for you, mm-hmm. that this could change. Final topic we'll cover tonight, and there's so much, but is on just preventive topics. And I think this was, you know, over the years, back when I was in dental school, xylitol was a very exciting topic, and we talked a lot about it, and there was a lot of hope and promise for it. Mm-hmm. I think that as we've really borne out that research, we found that it's maybe not as good as what we thought, as we've really gotten to randomized controlled trials.
They're hard to find.
Yeah, they're hard to find, and the ones we do have, they're not as good long-term as we wish they were, and it doesn't mean that xylitol is completely ineffective, but it just may not be as good as mm-hmm. what we hoped it would be.
Right.
But there is something new, arginine.
Yes.
And arginine does seem to be supported as increasing caries resistance in the mouth. And so I think that this is something we should be looking at because it's very new.
Right.
And toothpaste are just starting to be developed with it. And
it's in all the hygiene talk right now. Mm-hmm. It has been for the last year or so. We really start seeing people talk about it. I've had a few patients ask me about it. I think it's important that you start reading about arginine.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I don't think you should throw xylitol away.
Right.
We actually provide xylitol candies and things like that to help people wean themselves off some sugar,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I think that's a great way to do it. It's just that we thought that xylitol could have been like this miracle thing.
Right.
And I think there is some potential for it, but the randomized controlled clinical trials.
Yeah.
They're just not there.
Yeah, they're just not there. And what we do have is kind of showing up that it just is controversial as to how much of an effect there really is. So I think it's something to just be aware of. But there may be some new things coming out. One other thing I'll just bring up, and because we're kind of running low on time, but just another thing we talked about right before the show, coming back to implants. I just thought this was just kind of crazy. There, well, it was just interesting. You know, they quoted a study that had a very interesting study design. They looked at failed implants.
Oh, yes.
And then they said, okay, if we have a failed implant, we're going to measure the success of the replacement implant in the same site. So the question was, you put an implant in and it fails. So we're going to take that implant out and we're going to place a second implant and we're going to measure the success of the second implant.
Mm.
Now, I thought what my theory would have been, and think about this in your mind right now, what do you think is going to happen? You know, what I thought was the success rate of the second implant would be just as good as any success rate mm-hmm. we would see. Mm-hmm. It would still be in the 90%, hopefully high 90% range, even if the first one failed. But this study found only 73% success.
Kind of like root canals. Every time you do a root canal on a tooth, it goes down.
Yeah, it was very interesting because they said, could there be something going on with this actual site? Is the bone the problem? Is the site the problem? Why are we seeing such low success the second time? You would think that it would be equal. And it challenged a little bit about my thoughts about what I tell a patient. You know, if you have a failed implant,
the second one usually works.
Right. So should we be saying that to patients, or should we be saying, you got a problem in that area? Maybe the second implant has only a 73% success
rate. A classic comment that I give my patients is that, you know, if the first one doesn't work, most likely the second one will.
Yeah.
And I said, it's so rare that the first one doesn't work, but when we do have a failure, we can go right back in there and put another one in, and generally that second one does work. Now, I will say, in my clinical experience, that has been the case
mm-hmm.
up until last year.
Mm.
You know, I had a young guy that we took a tooth out on, okay, put an implant in, grafted it, buried it. It was amazing, okay? I even finished the case, okay? And then like 2 months later, the guy comes in. He's like, man, implant crown didn't feel right.
Hmm.
And I said, well, let's check it out. Sure enough, it was actually a graft failure.
Hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the whole graft dehisced.
Wow.
And so we took it out, rebuilt the site, tried another one. Guess what? Failed.
Oh, man.
Second one.
Oh, man.
So now we're going through the third rehabilitation here, and I told the guys, I said, look, man, I said, I think you ought to go get your blood tested. And I was like, how long has it been since you've been the doctor? And he's like, man, it's been 5 or 6 years since I've had a blood test. Go have it done. He even texted me. He was like, blood work came back great. And I was like, well, that's good. Because I was thinking something funky here.
Right.
So it could be site specific.
Yeah.
It could be a blood supply issue.
Maybe it's a blood supply issue. Maybe this is an issue of not enough blood supply. Maybe this is, could there be some medication things going on here? Do we need to look more at bisphosphonates? Mm-hmm. I mean, these are all the things that come to mind, but certainly gave me a little pause.
We have to be careful what we tell our patients. Yeah.
One closing thought here as we kind of finish this up, and this just comes back to our earlier discussion from tonight. If you're going to change a product in your practice, okay? So you listen to a podcast, you see something on Facebook, you read something in a journal, and you decide you're going to change something in your practice.
Like Wes and John said, this is freaking awesome.
Right. It's a great product. We gave you some journal support for it. Please read the instructions. Just because a product is great, just because it's been proven in literature,
it's been tested in
doesn't mean that you use it the same way as the last product that you used. Mm-hmm. So if you want to change bonding agents to something new because somebody told you it was great or a journal article told you it was great, it doesn't matter how good that journal article said that material is, it's going to fail if you don't use it according to the instructions that are provided with the product. And if you really aren't sure, call the product representative and have them give you some support to show you how to use it, because it's just crazy to us sometimes how, you know, somebody will tell us, they'll say, you know, well, you guys recommended this product and it just didn't work for some reason. And we just kind of go, you know, we don't just recommend things because they work in our hands. We actually read the literature and we rely on people much smarter that have done a lot more studies than we have. Mm-hmm. So we're pretty confident when we tell you something works, it's because it has scientific support. Mm. The question usually when we really start diving into this, Wes, it's almost always universally, they just didn't read the instructions.
It's very interesting to me what people, when you start questioning them about how they're using it, and then they're like, well,
They don't really know.
And then it's the whole story starts to come out. Well, I didn't. Oh, I didn't.
Right.
Oh, I didn't know. Right. Oh,
but the last one I used wasn't. I didn't have to do that.
Right. So
it's not that it's more difficult to use.
This is like a PS moment on this podcast.
It's
like
just a
PS.
Little. Right. Just remember when we're
of the week.
Because when we're going through, you know, you get these from us. You know, you get this right here. You know, from us, you get the Journal of Prosthetic Dentistry annual reviews, selected scientific literature. We pretty much take all this information. We try to pare it down for you into some things we think that are relevant. And we might even recommend a product or two that come out of that because we think that they are legit and they're scientifically supported. But we're not reading the instructions for you guys and girls.
No.
You know, you have, and your assistant shouldn't be either.
And honestly, there's a place for that.
For
instruction.
Oh, yeah.
And it doesn't come from a podcast.
No, it doesn't come from us. Like, we're going to tell you the scientific background, but it's up to you guys as the doctors to be the one that owns the products that you use and be the expert. It's not your assistant. Yeah. It's not your lab. It's not us.
I hope you're making the decisions in your practice about the products you're using and how you're using them.
Right.
Number two, if you're not, then change today.
Right.
Like, become the expert in what you do.
That's right.
Because it's like I've said before, if I hired somebody to paint my deck, you know, and they're a professional, they better daggone know what about the paint.
Right.
And they better know more than me about it.
Right. They better know which primer goes with which paint, and they better know how long to mix it, and they better know how long to let it cure and set. And these are not people that even have a college education a lot of times. Mm-hmm. We have a high-level education. We know things. We've taken chemistry courses. It is our responsibility to our patients to be the absolute experts at this and take pride in your work. So, yeah, we want you to take our recommendations.
Be more than just a doer.
Right.
Be more than just a doer.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Read the instructions. Understand the product before you start using it. And listen, there's always a trial period when you change. There's always a season of learning and figuring it out.
But don't let the first thing you blame be the product.
Oh.
So, you know, there's times we've all been there where we were the problem and we wanted to blame the product or we wanted to blame the lab or we wanted to blame someone, because it is so hard to blame yourself. Mm-hmm. But oftentimes I've found that when I thought that I was dealing with a bum product. It was something that I just didn't understand about it. Yeah. And so I think, you know, that's something we've learned and we've really tried to live by, and we just want to get that message out. Hey, you know, be the one to be the doctor, be the thinker, as Wes said, not the doer, because that's what separates us from somebody who's just a mechanic. You know, be the engineer, right, not the mechanic. Those kind of things we say all the time.
Hey, listen, this is the next level, right? Your practice. What are you going to do tomorrow to take it to the next level, right? What are you doing to improve to go to the next level? Many of you listen to this show and you say, you know what? It's because of you guys that I'm going to the next level.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we love. We love hearing those stories. We love the feedback about next level opportunities in your practice, whether it's just, hey, I'm doing X better because, you know, I just want to be better. I'm reading a journal and I'm learning more because I want to increase my knowledge about that subject.
Yep.
That's what we're talking about. We want to hear about that. We want you to become part of our community. We think it's cool. We have almost 1,000 likes on Facebook. We are really, really approaching 1,000. And I want to count down to 1,000 this year in 2019. Let's get to that 1,000 marks. If you don't like us on Facebook right now, go out and like us on Facebook. Secondly, we're on Instagram now. Okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so check us out over on Instagram. The third place we're at is Twitter. Check us out there on Twitter. And then the last place, too, I want you to check us out is on your favorite podcaster. You know, podcatcher, as they say. We're on Spotify, Stitcher,
Apple Podcasts. Yeah, everything. All these things, everything.
Right? Check it out. Look up the Dental Guys. Give us a 5-star review. Listen, tell us why you love it. And we just want to keep bringing you guys great content to help you go to the next level so that you can turn around and say, hey, you know what? My patients are benefiting from what I've learned.
Yep.
And that's what makes it.
That's what it's all about.
That's what it's all about.
That's what it's all about.
For John, I'm Wes, and we are the Dental Guys.